relationships, but you're wrong. Listen, there's no magic bullet. I'm teaching life skills.
When he's sick, you need medicine. It don't always taste good.
Oh, nah.
But it'll get you better. You need this medicine.
Yeah.
It ain't gonna always taste good. But this is what you need. Men and women, bottom line, we need to have the conversation. Your partner wants to give up control, but only if you know how to drive. This is about being the best you could ever be. Whoever you are, I don't care if you're a man, a woman, LGBTQ, space aliens. I'll save anybody, I don't care. I'll teach a hedgehog how to have a threesome.
What do you mean by that?
Look, you don't have to listen to me, but you're wrong.
Listen, I know I'm great. And I know you're thinking, Dante, there's no way I could be like you. But you could be me, you know why?
Because you know who I was? Before I was me, I was you. You.
Man score 202.
Better hear what I've got to say because you won't get it again.
I'm not an alpha male. I'm not a beta male either. I'm just a better man. Better man.
Well, put your happiness first, because if you don't, they won't.
What's up, y'all? GYBB, get your balls back. WWDD, what would Dante do? The sexual revolution is being podcasted, and I am excited. This is a special show. I know I've said that 500 times before, but this time I mean it. What's going on, Harry? You ready to rock and roll?
Oh, you know damn well I'm ready. I'm good. Why would you even ask me that?
Drizzle Dre, thanks for being
boom, boom,
on.
Boom, 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 boom.
Boom, boom, boom.
What is that?
That's some West Side Gun shit.
That's West Side Gun, Griselda. Uh-huh. That's the Buffalo hip hop. That's my new jam. Me and Dre been knocking songs back and forth. Like, it's real old school lyrical hip hop. Check that out. Conway the Machine and all of them. Anyway, I'm sorry, Javi. We got a special guest. Nick Angin.
That was the original title for your podcast on here. Nick was like, yeah, no, let's not do that.
Let's go with Slob's Theory. We got Javi in the building. Let me give the background. So I was doing I was doing Godfrey's podcast, and she came and sat on the podcast, and we was talking about other relationship gurus and stuff, and we kind of got into it, but it was like it was limited time, and I really was feeling her input and stuff, and I wanted to have her on us. Give it up for Javi, yo. Give it up for Javi, yo. Yeah. She looking like a revolutionary today, you know what I mean? By any means necessary. What's going on,
girl? Pam Grier.
Yeah. Well, that was revolutionary, Jay. Not a bad one.
Yeah, that's true. She a whole legend. Yeah.
That was better than my Harvey Weinstein. God damn, I just woke up. I apologize, Jay. I just woke up. What's going on, Mama? How you doing?
I'm awesome.
Good. We want to get into this. Dre, you watched a little bit of Kevin Samuels, right?
I've seen like clips on Twitter.
Yeah.
But that's the extent of it.
I get you.
I'm very well versed in the Kevin Samuels universe.
You are very well.
The Marvel universe, DC, and Kevin Samuels.
Yeah.
Harry's in Black Twitter deep, heavy.
Yeah.
Heavy and Black Twitter.
I got sucked in, and I'm there now. So I'm familiar with him. I mean, it's
Dexter
it's
Jackson.
Yeah.
You all in.
I'm all in. Some of them, it's that and Inside the NBA is dominating my YouTube feed now.
I really
love Inside the NBA.
Inside the NBA is great. But Kevin Samuels, there's some stuff I agree with him on, and then there's other stuff where I'm like, I don't think he's helping anybody. Is my big problem.
Okay,
Samuels. But
Javi, let me. People to shower. I seen a clip like that. That was good advice. People. He was telling dudes to shower.
Yeah,
that's sound advice.
How long we been doing that?
Open mics, and open mics be funky. These niggas don't shower for days. The jokes don't come out your armpits, nigga. You gotta take a bath. The fuck?
Hey, Dre, how long we been telling niggas to shower?
Like, why don't they listen, sir?
I don't know, sir.
What's happening?
We need a bigger platform.
Oh, fuck. Or soap. Maybe that's what we missing.
Maybe we need to just scrap the podcast and just... soap. Just hand out soap. Go right. Grassroots.
Beam a nigga in the back of the head with a Jergens. Shower, nigga. Gross ass.
Get some ivory. Ivory's cheap. You can get 40 bucks.
What's that? The Irish Spring Bar. That'll knock him out cold. Yeah, he'll wake up clean.
That's a big bar. That's a big bar. Javi, tell me what your experience is, and then we'll get into this heavy, hot and heavy.
My experience with Kevin Samuels?
Yeah, what's your experience? What you know?
Yeah, well, I know him from the original video where the woman was like, I want a high value man. She makes whatever she made. And he was like, you're not going to find that. You know, you're a seven at best. I think he asked her to rate herself. And then she had some issues with like her baby daddy. And he basically just started slicing from there. Like, you're not going to find what you're looking for. I think she said she wanted a six figure man.
Well, he
could be anything from $100,000 to, you know,
$900,000.
So that's a huge range right there.
Right, right.
And I think he asked her, like, so, you know, what is it about you that this man would want? And she started out with like, I'm a business owner, I garden. And he just started like
ripping it to pieces.
Don't care about that. That's
I
not
like gardening. You know. I need plants. And I got a little garden in the backyard.
Little basil, fresh basil, some rosemary.
Got some basil, son.
I think that, like, I understand his perspective from the point of, like, okay, men are not looking for the same things women are looking for.
Right.
But the way that he communicated it to her wasn't helpful, and he didn't give her anything that was actionable. Like, I think that's a huge problem with him. You're telling people, oh, you're an eight at best. First of all, that's subjective, because I might be a 10 to you. I might be a 4 to Harry. I might be a 6 to Dre. Like, that's completely subjective. And outside of that, to tell somebody, hey, you're 300 pounds, you ain't gonna find a high value man. Okay, so what can I do? Like, how can I improve my... you know, live on what I'm looking for. And
hot yoga, Bikram. Bikram yoga.
You gotta do something. You're 300.
Right. Well, yeah. I mean, that's an exaggeration. But, you know, not every high value, I'm just going to use that term just for this, you know, we're all on the same page. Every man who's worth something is not looking for a size 2 or a size 4. But you can get to your best self and then take it from there. Also, like, where are you at in life? Like, you know, I think some of it is exposure. Like, you're not going to meet certain men at your local bodega. But I feel like those are, you know what I'm saying? Like, I think you just go straight to tearing somebody down, but not giving them something that they can actually implement in their life that would make a difference. So to me, I don't think he's helping. I just find him to be very toxic. Some of the things are useful, it's hard to take it in after you finish slicing and dicing. You know what I'm saying?
I mean, I think that's a problem. I think Black community has that problem in general, is that they give more of a fuck about the packaging than they do what the actual message is. Right. And I think overall, you're in a you know, in a space where I totally understand that it's this. This constant idea of well, I want you got to tell it to me, and I find that about Black women. Absolutely, find that about Black women. Super fragile about hearing the truth. I definitely think that they have a inflated sense of self. I you know, you see this all the time when Black women go. Black women are going, oh, I'm a strong Black woman. No, you're just a bitch. Like, you're just rude. You're just this. And I'm not saying that's everybody, but I'm saying a lot this under the guise of this. I mean, I've had the same thing when I counsel guys, and guys will get on here and, you know, and they'll be like, oh, my wife is a hot Latina. You know, those hot Latina. And I'm like, I don't give a fuck whether she is on fire in Puerto Rican. It don't matter. Being rude is being rude.
Absolutely.
being uncivil and unkind is being unkind, no matter what your nationality is. And sometimes, somehow, oh, you know, she's a Sicilian. It's always this kind of guise of because of your nationality.
Yo, don't be Sicilian somewhere else. Yeah, that's the whole thing. It's just what you tolerate. Oh, you spicy Latina, go be spicy in the corner.
But obviously he likes that, right? Like some men like that they like to be told off. They like to be spoken to a certain way. So evidently that's something, if that's his wife, it must work for him.
Andre, you want to
disagree with a lot of stuff. I disagree with mad shit.
On which part, Kevin Samuels or with Javi?
If a dude, all right, dude has a spicy Latina or whatever, or any woman that's yelling at him all day.
Oh, that's horrible.
Even if they, because you can attach it to like masochistic sex or something, it's still rooted in something of a dislike of yourself. It still has a negative place, even if you found a way to like it.
Where's my bell? I can't find my bell. My bell.
Like fuck it, you know what I'm saying? Exactly, like I don't agree with any of that. And then even with the black women thing, I don't think it's a black women thing. It's more like the ones that are uneducated and not educated in the idea of school, just about like yourself. Like anybody who has like an ill version of self-worth puts out a crazy image to try to compensate for the shit.
That's huge.
Anybody that's feel okay about themselves, they good, they chilling.
See, that is more what this whole thing is about. And like, obviously if you're going to Kevin Samuels, there's something about you that's not 100% okay, because you already know how the man gets down. Right. To go to somebody and to have them be like, okay, like for example, myself, I'm not in my 20s, I'm divorced, I have a child. Also, then girl, what are you talking about? You're talking about a high value. You should just get whatever you could get. That's essentially what he would tell me. So if I already know that this is his platform, why would I personally put myself, because you're so used to that toxicity and you have a low self-worth.
It's kind of like rap, where you think about conscious rap, and Jay-Z said I had to dumb it down so I could get like, they want that version for the masses because that's what people enjoy. They want to hear the shit go buck wild.
That's the Jerry Springer.
There's some showmanship to the shit going on.
Yeah, that's the Jerry Springer thing. The Jerry Springer syndrome is where people want somebody to wrestle in a bowl of Jello.
Yeah, like everybody could do some nice conscious rap, but they're like, nah, tell me you shot somebody.
Yeah.
Where the drugs at, nigga?
Well, you know, it's also, first of all, so Harry, you want to chime in this? Because I got a lot on this. So
yeah, so the thing about Kevin Samuels is like, number one, what you're talking to Javi is correct. Like at this point, you're just, you know what you're getting when you go on, especially women who choose to get themselves rated. I mean, there's literally hundreds of videos of this guy going, all right, you are not hot, you're not attractive enough. So I don't know anyone at this point who goes on there and rates themselves, know they're in for a problem, especially a girl who comes in at two bills.
I didn't know he did that. He's like a rating thing.
Somebody said on another podcast that there are people who actually pay to get a consultation.
You can get relationship wise, but on his shows, people will come on the Instagram live.
He'll be like, she'll be giving him fever. He go, okay, fine. You want, she goes, well, what is left for me? And he'll go, rate yourself on a scale of 1 to 10. You can't use seven, which I do like. It's good. Seven is an easy bet.
Everyone would rate themselves as a seven. It's an easy thing, right? But
according to him, Beyonce is a seven, though. So like, I mean,
that's a little nuts. But
he said Beyonce is a seven.
No, he said Beyonce is an eight. Kelly Rowland's a nine. That's what he says.
Holly Berry, now, he says, is a 10.
Kelly Rowland is fire, though.
Yes. Right, right.
Kelly Rowland is.
Well, I mean, I don't want to, you know, the debate is not about the number, but I mean, what he's doing is setting it up. So, and then he says you can't do a 7. So a 6 makes you go, damn, I'm just above, even if you think you fly, you're just above average. That's why I do, my rating system is 1 to 30. I do 1 to 30. So
my rating system is, would I hit And that's the end.
That's a bad. Yeah, that's a bad reputation.
You got a thumbs up. Andre got a thumbs up. A thumbs
what
down.
I hit? Ah, still okay.
But that's a bad rating system because every guy has that rating system, and a lot of women fall under the "would I hit" category.
Thumbs up.
Earth is populated, ain't it?
Some of the women who've come through there, because I try to explain this to my girl, she's like, "Why would you?" I'm like, "Sometimes you just want to eat. It's not a you don't care if the restaurant is.
We go to McDonald's.
I don't think it's like that. I feel like it's kind of like when you said people pick seven.
Yeah,
I think it's because, bro, most. Like a good amount of women fucking look good. Like, I don't know how
well, it's average.
Like
it's
a,
average.
Like a high number.
Seven is average.
It's average, but it's also like in this society, you think you're a 10. You say you're a 10. People are like, who the hell do you think you are? You're not going to give yourself too low a grade. You know what I'm saying? Like,
yeah, seven, but there's eight, chicks that come on there straight up. I'm a 10, and I'm like, you a 4, ma. Right. Like a 3. You a 3.25. Stop. Right. And then she got 4 kids. She got 3 baby daddies. You got to subtract for that. So then,
the thing with Kevin Samuels, his whole audience or this fan base, which is a very bizarre fan base, seems to be gold diggers to some extent. Women who go,
why do you
I
think
wanna...
that?
Wait. Yeah, that's interesting. Why
because,
you say that?
Because
digger?
When he goes, how much do you think? They go, not only do I want 6 figures, I want to be able to high 6 figures, right? He'll ask, and it's high 6 figures.
No, he'll say 6-figure male.
Right.
That's what
he'll
he
say
says.
6-figure, but then he goes in. He'll go into the specifics of it. All right, this is what it's going to cost, which I do like that he has the stats. So I'll give what I like about it. He does have the stats. He goes, listen, how many kids do you want? Do you want to work? Do you want to stay home? No, I want to raise the kids myself. Okay, so if you want to raise the kids and not work, and you want 3 kids, and you want to put them all through school, that's going to require a guy who is making at least $500,000 a year. Right, he'll always throw that out.
That's a marine biologist, and them niggas is not tall.
Sorry,
not even marine biologists. Marine biologists don't make that much.
They don't make that
because they're not doing nothing. You know.
So that's an NBA player. Then you got to do.
Okay, now here's the killer. He says
$500,000 is a lot of money.
No, but he says he says no. He says no NBA players, no entertainers. He starts off with that. So what he's talking about is corporate black men, right? Oh. Corporate black men making 6 figures or better. So what I think what people don't understand is
to look that up. What jobs make that much money?
But
salesmen.
Where you live, right? Because you could be living in
lawyers.
I see what you're saying, Javi.
It's different. Like you're not gonna need $500,000 to support 3 children in Atlanta. Maybe you would need, depending on the lifestyle you want in New York City, it's going to be different. So I think that's huge to this because depending on where you want to live.
I think we're getting too far in the weeds. What I think you have to understand is what he's doing is he's framing an argument before the girls come on or whoever comes on his show. He's already framed the argument. So first of all, he's eliminated singers, band people, dancers, comics, actors, everybody, ball players and athletes. So he's already removed that away from it. What he's specifically talking about is corporate black men making over $100,000 a year.
Well, he's trying to keep it realistic because the odds that you're going to be with an entertainer, an actor, or a basketball player are there's very few people who do that.
The odds that you're going to be with the odds that you're going to meet a black man over making over $100,000 is 2%. That's still
2%. That's why women should open it up. My personal opinion, because when you talk about marriageable, because the goal is marriage, right?
Yeah.
You talk about marriageable black men, that's one of the biggest pieces of advice he could give to these women. What's more important to you, a lifestyle or making sure that you stay with a black man? If it's a lifestyle, start opening it up and stop restricting yourself to just black men, because like Harry is saying.
Well, but he asked that too. He does ask that too. Are you willing to swirl? He says, do you want a black man? They say, go ahead. What are you going to say, Harry?
So regardless of whether it's a black man or not, just going by the figures, the thing that I don't like is that he never breaks down what they could do. Like, hey, when he tells a woman, you know, you're not going to marry a 6-figure man because the odds are you got 3 kids. already, you know, you're
nobody wants that
certain amount of weight. There's very few people that are going to want that. You have no house skills or you don't have a background, whatever. But he never she goes, well, what do I do then? You know, he never goes, hey, you can find love. You just have to be open to other things. It's always about finances on both sides, though, because both people involved. I never hear a discussion about actually finding love. It's always about marrying and finding somebody who makes six figures to take
care of
you.
That's exactly what I'm saying to you, is that what he's doing is he's shaping the argument before you even come. You're already eliminating a major portion of six-figure black men by taking athletes, entertainers, and so on. He's not even, I don't even know if he's really saying entrepreneurs. What he's saying is corporate men who this is what they want. So first, so you've already eliminated a large portion of it when the reality is, in terms of systemic racism, that is a difficult nut to crack simply because of the fact that they're still cutting little black girls' hair off. And I just watched this thing with the softball where they cut this little black girl's braids off because she was playing softball and giving them the business, told her she had to cut her hair. That's why she couldn't play the softball game. So there's a systemic, not just a systemic, but a cultural racism that's in place that doesn't allow that, that makes that a difficult nut to crack. The point of it is that he's setting the real point of it is that he's setting up an argument saying this is the not entertainers, not ball players, not corporate males over $100,000 is considered a high value male. So what he's doing is he's putting the prize, the trophy is that he's setting. So he's already, it's almost like me saying, yo, how often do you beat your wife? You're framing the question in a way that doesn't allow the openness, because then you gotta retort that, hey, I don't beat my wife. Yeah, but when you did beat your wife, how? I don't beat my wife. So you gotta start there. So people are coming on there. First of all, people wanna be famous. They wanna be on, you know, famous. So they want to get that clip so they could come on and talk, because there's tens of thousands of people on there. Secondly, what you're talking about is black trauma. You're talking about extreme black trauma based on racism that happened to your parents, the parents before people who have emigrated here, people who are descendants of slaves, a combination of that, microaggressions on a day-to-day basis. And so we're, you know, as a whole, I think black people have to understand that we are traumatized in a way that we don't understand. And because of the normalcy of trauma, what we do is you're going to this guy for an ass whipping. With the pretense of, oh, I'm going to show him, but it ain't really,
Is it like when people go to like D.L. Hughley shows or Don Rickles when they used to roast people in the crowd and they went for the experience? Yes,
yeah, like roasting? Especially Hughley hit, because Hughley just was so quick. They would go to get roasted.
That's funny.
But sometimes they would go to get roasted with the saying, oh, he ain't going to get me, I'm going to get him, you know. Right. But dog,
Hughley whipped that ass.
So, we talk about this. We've been talking about this for 8 years when we talked about the whole, we have a premise of, Javi, about what we call the brackish women. So the whole premise came from these fish called African cichlids. They grow in Africa, in Tanzania, in a pond that is surrounded by tribes. They shit in it, they eat in it. That's their source of water. Those fish grow in that water. So they're some of the prettiest, colorful freshwater fish. They're not actually freshwater, but it's a mix of salt and freshwater. But there's a bacteria. So when you put those fish in a fish tank, you have to cultivate a bacteria in the water before you put the fish. If you try to put those fish in clean water, clean, non-toxic, low pH, the fish die. And so what we have to look about in terms of black people is the black trauma that we go through. Yes. That we're not even acknowledging, that we're pushing down so much. Absolutely. that you're because the normalcy of that toxic stuff, and we all have it. We have it. I mean,
but with Black women, I think even another step, which I feel is also part of this, because in society, when you talk about the systemic racism, you talk about the legacy of Black women who had the male ripped from the home very early on. So many women grew up in these single parent households, women who are constantly, this is where the whole I'm a strong Black woman comes from.
Absolutely.
To hold on to that. And now I think there's a collective also too. White women were always held up as a lily of the valley. They're there to be protected. They're right. They're feminine, etc.
You milk be the milkmaid for my children so I can maintain my body.
Right. And so now you, and then now Black women as a collective are like, well, I don't have to be the mule. I don't have to work my finger to the bone. I would love to be with a man who is a provider and that can, you know, I want some of these same benefits that white women are getting. And for that, there's been this huge backlash. And I think he also is using that trauma and pain as well against Black women. Then also turning to them and saying, oh, look, you have a bad attitude, so you don't deserve this. Oh, look, you make six figures. Oh, you outwork the man. It's like you want the woman to be independent, but at the same time, you want to punish them because
of the independence, because of the success.
Listen, you need, if a man is not there, you obviously are, you know, trying to make a life for yourself. You can't just sit around and fan yourself until this great, you know, savior comes in.
Right.
And so you need a little bit of masculine energy in order to compete in that.
Well, you can't look, I've said this, I've dealt with plenty of Black women in corporate America and stuff. And if you are a successful Black woman in corporate, you are a beast. First of all, you're super efficient because you got to be five times better than any white dude. And not only that, but what is interesting, and I don't think that people talk about this enough, is that white corporate America uses the ferocity of Black women to protect their money. Yeah. People always talk about Black women in customer service and this and how awful they are in customer service. That's by design. See, if you're not giving things back, if you're not giving, but if you got to deal with somebody who's difficult, listen, you ain't going to be telling me, blah, 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 blah. That is a way to protect your money. So that people act like that's by accident. It's not by accident. That's by design to protect white male finances.
Absolutely.
You put the pit bulls at the front row and then nobody don't get nothing back, you know?
Right. But then,
and then she's rewarded.
Yeah.
For this behavior, because this is who I want, you know, protecting my money, you know.
The problem is that, and which is what I feel Black women often get rioted for, is not being able to turn that off when it comes to their personal life.
And I agree.
Men, right? So you know why they are this way. I think the work and the training and the advice should go in that, like, hey, that's great when you're at work, fine. But when you're with a man, you gotta kind of fall back a little bit, receive, not be that person who's ready to jump on him and tell him, you motherfucker, you ain't shit or whatever. I mean, that's really more, I feel, to blame for, you know, why you have women who can't find these men, because they don't know how to find that balance between, hey, I'm at work, I'm hard, I gotta get this done, versus I'm with my man, I'm gonna let him lead, I'm gonna kind of.
Yeah, but here's the other thing about that, Ed, is you get to lead when you deserve to lead. So this thing of telling Black women that they need to be softer, look, they need to be polite and civil in a way that they want to be treated. But the thing is, you have to build Black men up so that they're stronger. It's their base is stronger, because if their base is stronger, it's like I've always said, you know, I've said this about Andre a lot. It's just he's very clear about what he will tolerate and what he won't tolerate. And it's not like he's not fighting you, but from a dude who's gone through a lot of personal and family trauma, the clarity in which he understands what his happiness looks like and what he's going to tolerate, was it just doesn't leave room for you to be reckless, cussing me out and throwing shit at me and stuff like that.
But right. if you have a situation where because you're, and this is another thing I find more and more is always there's always an abuse off. Black men and black women always have an abuse off. Well, you know, black women have traditionally had that. Yeah, we all fucked up because for black men to see women disenfranchised and abused and stuff, it's traumatic for us as black men to not be able to step up and to protect black women as much as it is, you know. So and then what's interesting, black women, like something you said that was interesting, it's like, you know, to watch these black men being taken away and this and that. We're trauma. So you can't say my trauma is better than yours because I'm not saying you are. I'm saying, but this is so you can't say that my trauma is bigger because I watch black men be abused. And then also my trauma is because I get abused. So the black guy who's getting abused, I'm quite sure the trauma that he's dealing with, prison and all these other things, the death by a thousand cuts, is something that he's dealing with. The problem is everybody's having a fucking abuse off. Who is more abused? Who is more likely? When the reality is, as a unit, we are talking about 400 years of trauma, and it ultimately raises his head to people going on some dudes, somebody who else who also is traumatized. And there's a simple thing, it's hurt people. So you can't go statistically, this is what it is. I'm giving you the statistics. I'm giving you the truth. Yeah, I agree. And don't get me wrong. I think what his statistics are dead on. But you're not checking the variable. There's more variables in that. If you go, because he's saying six-figure male, black, in corporate America. Okay. So you've already limited that. Then you go, well, what about if he's abusive? What about if he's physically abusive? What if he's unattractive? What if he's lousy in bed? What if he doesn't have any, no ability to express intimacy or emotion? So now you're saying you black women make this deal because you want it. Now, don't get me wrong. I'm going to tell you something that's really interesting. I have older sisters. I have an older sister who right now has nobody and has always been a cunt, always been nasty, and she is going to die alone. That is going to happen. Prior to her living with me, she had a boyfriend. They were supposed to get married. Once he retired, they were going to get married. And this dude was... I had to check him a couple of times because he, you know, they was calling each other, you fucking bitch, you cunt. And she was like, you ain't shit. And he, you know, and you know, like they were doing, you know, kind of. And we're not talking about kids. We're talking about in their 70s. Just the same. That's trauma.
That's the funniest fucking thing to ever see to me. To see 2 70-year-old people. You motherfucker. Yo, bitch.
Dre, I mean, I don't. Turkey. Dre, I never told you the story. I don't even think I ever told the story. It's a crazy story.
They were cursing 70-year-old, like, old nigga terms.
Like, as nigga. Dre, you been to my house in front of the house. In front of the fucking house.
70 years old.
All right, so let me give you they were dating, right? And they were supposed to get married after he retired, and they were gonna move to North Carolina or get a house or something. So Dre, I can't believe I never told you this story. So I got a call from my sister. Like she was crying, and it's like Christmas Eve, and she says to me, I go, what's wrong? She says, he called me out of my name. I go, well, what did he call you? He called me a bitch and a cunt and a slut and told me to shut the fuck up. And I go, what? So I say to her, I go, if somebody speaks to you like that, you that already tells you where, you know, the level of how this is going to operate. So I said to her, you know, I was telling her how to handle it was to create distance between him and her. And then he was like chasing her. I want to talk to you. Cause that's even common. But when he comes back, I said, you have to create the boundaries. You have to create those boundaries. What's acceptable. And the minute he
crosses those boundaries, you have to, you know, you have to, you got to bounce. Right. It's not about arguing. It's about creating a balance. So I don't know if I tell you this, Jay. So like I said, you know, I was telling her, so she was like, I'm not talking to him. And she was crying and giving me all this. I said, you, okay, whatever. I said, because, you know, I just want to, so the dude wasn't coming around. He used to come around all the time. He stopped coming around. So on New Year's Day, my mom, Dre, Gary, I told you this, right? My mom, so for New Year's, before my mom died, I took my mom out for New Year's. I had a bunch of shows and I took her with me. And as we're coming back home, my mom was lit because she had a lot of red wine. And so so I come up and the dude is waiting for her to come. And so he sees me and he says, oh man, you know, I just wanted to talk to you. I think you misunderstood, you know, what, because she had told him that she told him. So he was nervous because he didn't want to get the smack down from me. So he came and I said, dog, I don't really have nothing to do with this. But he just kept insisting he wanted to talk to me. And he goes, you don't understand. I said, all right, well, since you want to talk about this, let's talk about it. I said, did you call my sister out of her name? Did you call my, he goes, you don't understand such and such and such and such. And so he's a dude who overtalks you. And I go, look, understand this kid. You're not going to overtalk me. So, but you wanted to talk about this. So let's talk about, did you call my sister out? Yeah, well, there's more to it and you got to understand. I go, I don't have to understand. I just need you to answer the question. So she comes out, right? Cause they're getting ready to go out for New Year's, right? This is after all of this bullshit, after she's got me involved. But she had told him, she had told the dude that he better not come around because I was mad. Now, I don't even get along with my sister, so he wasn't even going to get no smoke because I don't fuck with her anyway. But this dude came around and he wanted to explain to me. And while I'm on this, Andre and Dre, y'all know the house. We're standing on the steps. It's New Year's Eve. He goes, you don't understand. She called me a faggot, right? And I'm like, what? So now here's the caveat to that.
Did he shake before you said that?
Yes, he did shake.
She gonna call me.
and his teeth slipped a little bit when he said the F and faggot and teeth came.
A couple people next door dropped their teacups.
Oh man, it was somebody said I do declare, right? Here's the caveat to that. Before I said, she was telling me the story how he called him out of her name. I said, well, what did you say? Because the story didn't matter. She was like, I said, did you curse at him? Did you call him names? No, I did not. I would never do that. Mm-hmm. I would never talk like that. I don't even use
all
those
words. All I said was oatmeal raisins, not that good.
She was like, I would never say anything.
Why your sister sound like Foghorn Leghorn?
I was like, so you telling me he just called you a bitch and a cunt out of the blue? I go, this don't even add up. So she's go, well, I wouldn't even use those words. I go, you didn't say nothing to him. And then
but say the F one. You go, that's what the trick was. You didn't say.
She is an F bomb, right? So I said, you gotta be kidding me. And I said to my sister, she's standing on the steps. I go, you call him that's what you called him? I go, and then you're all of a sudden you're so broken because he called you names. I go, you both deserve each other. Both of you broken motherfuckers deserve each other in a way. You should love each other because you're the same awful human beings. I said, I can't believe. I said, I specifically asked you like 8 times. You didn't say nothing. You because it just didn't seem right. So she sent him, she called him a faggot, told him he couldn't keep his dick hard. Like, she went in and then, like,
you should have said, bitch, I'm 70.
70.
You should be 70. Proud of me for being able to pee. Leave me alone.
You should be proud of that I can remember your name. You're like, what the fuck is. And I was like, don't ever get me involved in this shit. But but I mean, so this was firsthand, this kind of trauma. Like, so, and my sister was always an abusive person, just an abusive party girl, but always abusive and always, you know, to oh, you didn't, it was always the head movement and stuff.